Hello, Chris Godinez, licensed professional counselor, also the host of We Need to Talk with Chris Godinez. I am on the road right now in Tombstone, so if it's a little loud, that's why. So today's video is for informational and educational purposes only. If you feel you need a therapist, this is not a substitute for therapy. If you feel you need a therapist, please go to Psychology Today, look up a therapist in your area on Google, and it will have all of the therapists in your area. Okay. The views and opinions stated herein are mine and mine alone. They do not represent the ACA, APA, or any other therapist for that matter. Okay, so today's video is on cognitive dissonance and why we keep returning to abuse and why we as the abused and the family members have a hard time understanding the abuse. So there's a lot going on and I'm not really sure where to start. So let's talk about cognitive dissonance first. So cognitive dissonance is where you have information coming in that is contradicting what is really happening. So this is gaslighting. This is what abusers do, is they will tell one story and make you believe it's true, even though it's not true. And then when you're confronted with it, your brain kind of goes like, and doesn't understand. And it's like, well, wait, you're telling me this, but I know that. And so that's cognitive dissonance. So when the incoming information does not match reality. And what happens is with abuse targets, we want to believe our abuser. We want to believe that they are telling us the truth. So when they are not telling us the truth, it makes us question reality. It makes us doubt what we know to be true. And that's when we start going, wait, is this real? Is this not real? So what ends up happening is when you're in an abuse situation, it's safer to believe the abuser than it is to believe the family and the friends that see the abuse for what it is. So you will, as an abuse target, you will defend your abuser to the death, which is why so many people have such a hard time wrapping their heads, especially family and friends, around the idea that the abuse target will defend the abuser and go back to them multiple times. So on average, it takes 7 times leaving an abuse situation for the target of abuse to finally leave. Why? Because of the cognitive dissonance, because of the fear, because what we do as human beings is we will attack a safer target. So say, for example, the family and friends are going, hey, this person's an abuser, this person's an abuser, this person's doing this, that, and the other thing to you. Well, it's not safe for the target of abuse to confront the abuser and go, look, I know exactly what you are and I know exactly what you're doing. Why? Because the abuser will continue to abuse and they will ramp it up. But what the abused will do is turn around and viciously attack the family and the friends that see the abuse for what it is. And it's because we are attacking a safer target. It's not safe to confront the abuser, but it is safe to confront the family and the friends. So this is where the abuser plays on this and makes sure to push out the family and the friends that see the abuse happening and know the abuse for what it is, because they want to isolate. They want to get rid of every single family member, every single friend, every single acquaintance, every single employer, every single anybody who sees the abuse for what it is. And they play on that cognitive dissonance that the target has. And this is all unconscious, guys. This is not like you wake up in the morning and go, hey, I think it would be a really great idea to be completely isolated from all my family and friends and to quit my favorite hobbies and to stop doing the things I love and to throw my kids under the bus and to do whatever else we're doing. So it's basically, it's an unconscious thing, and it's a survival mechanism, and it's a very dysfunctional survival mechanism. Now let's talk about fight, flight, freeze, or fawn, okay? And I'm going to be throwing a lot of information at you. So fight, flight, freeze, or fawn plays into the cognitive dissonance. So basically what's happening is when we are attacked, when our little amygdala, remember the amygdala? Talked about the amygdala? It's that little almond-shaped organ that sits about an inch inside of each ear. When that is feeling threatened, it senses an attack coming in, okay? It starts sending off a distress signal to the hippocampus hypothalamus, which tells the body to release cortisol, which is our stress hormone, which then makes us tense up, and then we're getting ready to kill something, run away, freeze, or fawn, give in to the abuse so that we don't get more abused, okay? Then what happens is it tells another, because we're tight and we've got no oxygen CO2 exchange going on, tells another part of our brain, oh my gosh, we're really gonna die. Here's the adrenal gland. Hey, adrenal gland, release all the adrenaline at once. So then we release all the adrenaline at once. So now we've got the adrenaline running. We're tense, we're shaking like a leaf, racing thoughts, no oxygen CO2 exchange. Then we either go into a full-blown panic attack or we go into a rage attack. So when we have been confronted with the truth about our abuser, 9 times out of 10, what we will do is go into a rage attack against the family member or friend that has pointed out exactly the behavior that they're doing. And it sucks, because that serves to push the family member away, when really the anger is actually directed at the abuser, but it's not safe. So they take it out on, we take it out on, the family members and the friends that see the abuse going on. Safer target. So basically what happens is, the reason why we keep returning to abuse, and this is something that is very near and dear to my heart, because it makes me very angry when people are like, oh, they enjoy the abuse. Oh, they must like it. They keep going back. Here's what's happening. The cognitive dissonance is creating the fog, the fear, false evidence appearing real, the guilt, the obligation, fear, obligation, and guilt. So it's creating the fog. And when we are confronted with leaving the abuser, our brains go into panic mode. Why? Because we've been groomed by our family of origin to be abused. So we have a fear of being alone, a lot of us. Not all of us, but a lot of us have got a huge fear of being alone. And so when the thought of being alone comes up, it's overwhelming. Why? Because the inner child is the one running the show at that point in time. The inner child, the one who got damaged by the original caregiver, the one who was 4, 5, 6 years old, is the one running the show. And that little guy, little girl, does not want to be abandoned and is terrified. So the thought of being alone is overwhelming. So think of it like a little 6-year-old thinking about being abandoned. Even though this person is abusing them, it's almost as if they would rather have negative attention than no attention at all, just like a little kid. So this is why I keep telling you guys, it's super, super, super important that you get the inner child under control. The inner child is the one that is running the show. The inner child is the one that causes us to continue to go back to abuse. And it takes, on average, 7 times leaving an abusive situation before it finally sticks. Why? Because it's no different than an addiction. I'm going to keep pushing this until everybody understands this. What we are addicted to is not the abuse. I'm going to say this again. What we are addicted to is not the abuse. We are addicted to the intermittent positive rewards. So when our little brain goes, oh, they love me, it's okay, everything's fine, everything's good, they're back to the way they were, they're love bombing me, it's awesome, they love me again, everything's great, but boom, then they leave us, or they threaten to leave us, or they abuse us, or they put us down, or they tell us we're terrible, or whatever, then we're in that horrible, awful, oh God, I feel awful, I feel terrible, I'm going to be abandoned, this is awful, oh no, wait, no, they love me, it's like a roller coaster ride, and we are addicted to that high. Okay, because our endorphins, dopamines, norepinephrines, all of those things are getting stimulated at an incredible pace. So it is no different than being addicted to a substance. That's what I keep telling everybody. And we are not addicted to the abuse, and anybody who says otherwise needs to have slap therapy performed upon them. So we're not addicted to the abuse. We are addicted to the intermittent positive rewards. Intermittent positive rewards. That's what we're addicted to. And that's why it's so hard to quit. That's why it's so hard to put down that drug. That's why it's so hard to walk away from an abusive relationship. Because we think, little 6-year-old us, little 5-year-old us, little 3-year-old us, however old we were when the abuse happened originally, thinks that we're never going to be loved again. And the abusers play into that. How many times have you guys heard, no one will ever love you like I do? No one will ever treat you the way I do. Parents do this to their kids too. You know, I've treated you so well. They do the martyr routine. I've treated you so well. I'm the best parent in the world. You'll never find somebody who loves you. You're an ungrateful child. You're this, you're that. Or if it's a lover situation, nobody's ever going to love you. Nobody's ever going to want you. Nobody's ever going to whatever. Fill in the blank. So that is what's going on. So it's the intermittent positive rewards that drive us to stay in the relationship because, like I said, the inner child is the one running the show. And that is no bueno. You do not want the inner child running the show. You want your adult running the show, because if you're allowing the inner child to run the show, you're going to stay with the abuser for years, decades, because you're terrified of abandonment. Because what the inner child is thinking is, oh my God, nobody's ever going to love me again. Nobody's ever going to want me again. Nobody's ever going to treat me well. Nobody's ever going to whatever. And we settle. We settle for that. Oh, they love me. Oh, no, they don't. Oh, no, wait, they love me again. So we would rather have that intermittent positive rewards than in what our minds is, no rewards at all. But what we don't understand is we are settling, and in a healthy, normal relationship, you don't have the roller coaster ride. You know your partner loves you, even if you're arguing with them. You do. You know that your partner is there, or you know that your parent is there, even if you're disagreeing with them. In an unhealthy, dysfunctional relationship, whether it be a parental relationship or whether it be a romantic relationship, in an unhealthy one, it's the threat. I'll leave you. I'll hurt you. I'll harm you. I'll do this. I won't love you. Okay? In a healthy relationship, there is none of that. It's like, hey, we're disagreeing, but I still love you. Hey, we're disagreeing, but you're still my child. Hey, we're disagreeing, but you're still my lover. Hey, we're disagreeing, but fill in the blank. You're still my friend. Okay? That's a healthy relationship. In an unhealthy, dysfunctional relationship, it's I love you, I love you, I love you, I hate you, I hate you, I hate you, I love you, I love you, I love you, I hate you, I hate you, I hate you. So it's that intermittent positive rewards that keeps us stuck. Absolutely 110% stuck. So you couple that with the six-year-old running the show, then you throw in gaslighting, okay? So now the abuser is lying to you. They're not telling you the truth. They're telling you that the family and the friends are evil, bad, wrong, horrible, terrible, awful people that just want to control you and just want to do this and just don't like them for no good reason. So actions speak louder than words. If the family and friends had not acted previously like that, why in the world would you think that they would start acting like that after you're with an abuser? Think about that. Put that in your pipe and smoke it. So there is that. So the abuser is now gaslighting. The abuser is changing history, rewriting history, convincing you that family and friends are evil, bad, wrong, horrible. And now you've got the cognitive dissonance because you know that your family and friends are one way, but the abuser is telling you something completely different. And then when they tell you that the abuser is not good for you, oh, well, that just confirms the abuser's worldview of the family and the friends. And then they set about to make you do their dirty work by screaming at them, raging, and getting them out of your life. So this is why it's so hard to leave an abusive relationship, because we have all of these things going on. And it's not just with a romantic relationship, it's with a familial relationship as well. If we're dealing with toxic parents, they will try to use one kid against the other. They will play kids off of each other. They will attempt to divide and conquer. So they will try to create dissonance or arguments between the two kids so that they hate each other. So they'll go to one kid and say one thing, and they'll go to another kid and say absolutely the polar opposite of whatever they just told the other child. They create situations of golden child, ignored middle child, and the comic, the scapegoat, things like that. And it's for a purpose. The reason they do this is because abusers need to have a person that they hate. They need to have both the target and them pointing their energy at somebody else so that they are not focused on what's really going on, which is the dysfunctional relationship, either between the parent and the kid or between the two lovers. So they always have somebody that they hate. They're always in conflict with somebody. Somebody is always the bad guy. Somebody is always the problem. And eventually what happens is either the target just toes the line and doesn't fight back and stays in the relationship. Remember, it's a matter of thirds. It's just like recovering from any addiction. A third of people never stop drinking. Another third of people stop drinking but then relapse. And then another third of people stop drinking and stay sober. So it's the same thing. So a third of people stay in abusive relationships, never leave. A third of people go back, leave, come back. Leave, come back. And then another third of people actually are able to get out, you know, probably after the seventh time, and go, that's it, I'm done. I'm done being abused. So the question is, are you done being abused? Are you willing to confront the cognitive dissonance? Are you willing to face the fear of the inner child and deal with that fear so that you are okay being by yourself? Because let me tell you something, guys, it is better to be alone for the right reasons than with anybody for the wrong reasons. And abusers want you to stay with them for all the wrong reasons. And the reason, the excuses I hear are, oh, but they're the victim. Bull tinky. Oh, but they had a tough childhood. Yeah, show me somebody who didn't. They don't all grow up to be abusers, guys. Oh, but they had fill in the blank. Victim, 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 victim. I'm sorry. Healthy, normal people do not abuse other people, period. So that is, wow, guacamole. That is, sorry, shiny. So that is what is going on, is that our abusers have done the cognitive dissonance, made us believe that no one will love us, and have played on that inner child being terrified of being alone. And the truth of the matter is, if you have family and friends that care enough to point out that an abuser is an abuser, you're never going to be alone. Ever. They may not be in your life, but they're sure as hell rooting for you in the backside. Absolutely. But an abuser is not. And an abuser continues to attempt to smear, and an abuser attempts to harm, and an abuser continues to attempt to control. So there it is. Okay, so let's talk about flying monkeys, because people had questions about flying monkeys last time. So what is a flying monkey? Just to review, a flying monkey is a family member or a friend who toes the line with the abuser. They allow the abuse to continue. You really expect me to eat while I'm talking. Yeah. Hold on one moment, please. Oh my God, that was disgusting, and I just dropped it on my pants. Sorry, jalapeno poppers. Okay, so it is somebody who allows the abuse to continue. It is somebody who encourages the abuse to continue. It is somebody who sides with the abuser. So many targets of abuse are just flummoxed by this. I mean, like, really, like, how? How is the family doing this? Well, there's a couple of things going on. One is either your family is the problem and you've got your original wound with that caregiver and they have found somebody in the abuser that is exactly like them, and boy, do they love them because, oh gosh, look, it's a mini them. And that's the narcissist wants somebody who's just exactly like them. So if you've got a narcissistic parent, they want you to get with somebody who's an abuser because they recognize that they're just like them and they enjoy it. Now, the only time they don't like that is if the abuser is actually in competition with controlling the target. Then they don't like that. But if they see that the target of abuse is trying to get away from the abuse, they will side with the abuser and encourage you to stay. Absolutely. So there is that. So flying monkeys agree with the abuser. Flying monkeys absolutely allow themselves or enjoy siding with the abuse, enjoy siding with the abuser. And they are probably narcissists or abusers themselves. Now, the other thing that could be happening is, remember, a lot of abusers are dark triads. So the dark triad, remember, is that I can't do that because I'm holding the phone, but it's a triangle. Hello, triangle. So you've got narcissism, you've got psychopath, and you've got Machiavellianism. So that means that they're psychopaths. And I don't know if you've ever come across a true psychopath. I'm sure you have if you've survived abuse. A true psychopath is charming, like nobody's business. I want you to think Ted Bundy, okay, serial killer. Could charm the socks off of anybody, convinced everybody he was not dangerous in any way, shape, or form. Oh, I love your son or daughter. They're the just most wonderful, and I just adore them, and they're great, and they're this, that, and the other thing, and I wouldn't hurt a fly. Meanwhile, they are plotting the target's demise, basically. So they're psychopaths. They charm. They're charming narcissists, charming sociopaths, charming psychopaths. And they are the ones who charm the family so that when the abuse is going on, nobody's going to believe the target of abuse. How many times have kids been abused and they've gone to a trusted teacher, family member, whatever, and said, so-and-so is abusing me, but because that person was either a respected member of the community, or because they were a respected member of the family, or they were, you know, somebody who was just so innocent and couldn't hurt a fly, nobody believed them. It's the same thing with a target of abuse. They have no one to believe them because the abuser is so charming and so manipulative that most people are not able to recognize it when they see it. A lot of therapists do not recognize it when they see it. Again, why? Because it's not taught in the schools, and that is a travesty, because oftentimes what will happen is you'll get the classic combination of a narcissist with a borderline. Quiet borderlines are vulnerable, guys. Quiet borderlines are the ones that the narcissists eat for breakfast, okay? It's a horrible situation. They'll come in and the therapist won't recognize that that's what's going on because nobody's trained them in what to look for, okay? So this is not healthy. This is not normal. this is not good. And this is why abuse goes on for so long, which is why I am doing these videos, because this needs to be talked about. This happens on a high school level. When I see kids dating in high schools, there's a lot of abuse going on. Narcissists preying on a weaker person or a borderline, yeah, you betcha. So this is why we need to talk about this. We do not talk about this enough. There is not enough education out there. There is not enough information out there. And we need to start talking about what abuse looks like, really. It's not how it looks in the movies. I'm going to say this again. Somebody was like, oh my God, I'm so glad you said that. It does not look like how it looks in the movies. It's not Farrah Fawcett in the burning bed. It's not the black eye. I mean, yes, it is. It can be. But the most prevalent form of abuse is emotional abuse. It's control. It's the abuser attempting to take over that person's life and isolate them from all family and all friends and their children and anybody else who could possibly be an influence on them or who sees the abuser for what they are. And they will lie about the family and the friends and the children and claim that the family, friends, or children are out to get them or are drug addicts or are lazy or are whatever in an effort to make the target of abuse believe the abuser and not the family member, the child, the friend who said, hey, this person is controlling you and manipulative and evil and we don't like them. There we go. There's something wrong with them. So, and the proof is in the pudding is because it's like if you as a target have now given up all your family and friends and the only family or friends you're allowed around are theirs, Houston, you got a problem. There it is. All right. So there is that. So how can you deal with the flying monkeys? How can you deal with helping the family members understand abuse and what is going on? Okay, it's hard. It really is, and it takes education. So if the family members and friends, okay, so here's the biggest mistake that family members and friends make is they stay quiet. They say nothing. They want to be Switzerland. They don't want to rock the boat, and they don't want to risk losing the target of abuse because it's been made very clear that if you tell me what I don't want to hear, I'm going to X you out of my life. Well, I'm sorry, but at the end of the day, you need to tell the abused what's going on. You've got to be able to sleep at night. So if you tell them what's going on and they still boot you out of their life, you let them know. It's like, hey, when the abuser's gone, you're more than welcome to come back. And I'm here rooting for you in the background. You let them know that. You shut the door, but you don't lock it. And you let them know, hey, I'm shutting the door because I'm not going to put up with your abuser. I'm not. I love you, but I'm not going to put up with your abuser. So you do that and you shut the door, but you don't lock it. And you let them know, when you're done being abused, I will be on the other side of the door. Are they ever going to walk through? They may not. But at least you have told them the truth, and you've let them know what you thought, and you also let them know that the abuser's lying, and that you're on the other side of the door should they ever choose to walk in through that door. That's all you can do. Now, as far as convincing family members and friends that you're being abused, you may not be able to. It depends on how far down their own rabbit hole that they are. Because if they're the ones that groomed you to be abused, it's really hard to convince another abuser to not abuse you. Or it's really hard to convince a family that is, what's the word I'm looking for? You know the old, it's not true, but that whole saying about ostriches, how they bury their heads in the sand. If they're so committed to burying their heads in the sand that they want to be Switzerland and don't want to get involved, then there's very little you can do. But the truth of the matter is the family members who absolutely refuse to say anything are actually aiding and abetting the abuser, period. If you tell me you want to be Switzerland and you don't want to get involved, but you're sitting there behind the scenes going, gosh, I'm really worried about this person, then guess what? You are aiding and abetting the abuser. So you have to pick a side. I'm sorry. You have to pick a side. Please pick the side of the abused. That's all I can say. So when you are talking about abuse, what the abuser will do is they will try to make you look like the crazy one. So they'll go into a counseling session and they'll try to get the counselor alone. And they'll try to talk to the counselor first. Oh, this person is so crazy. This person does this, that, and the other thing. As soon as a person does that to me and they're wanting couples counseling or tries to do that to me, and they're very manipulative. And sometimes they have succeeded in getting me alone, but I recognize when they are saying things about the other person without the person being there, that Houston, I'm dealing with probably somebody who is an abuser. So it's really important to find somebody who believes you. So finding a counselor that actually gets abuse is huge. And you want to go for somebody who is trained in domestic violence. That's your best bet. However, I've also had people tell me, oh my gosh, these people that are supposedly trained in domestic violence still don't get it. So it's really a matter of you tell your story and you keep telling your story and you keep telling your story, and it doesn't matter what the abuser is saying. The abuser is going to try to make you look crazy. They are going to do the smear campaign until the cows come home. They're just going to. So you have to do you, and you have to tell your story. And this, I think, is going to lead up into another video that I'm going to do on how to tell your story, because I've had people say, oh my gosh, I don't know how to tell my story. I'm so afraid of my abuser. I'm so afraid of being sued. I'm so afraid of this. I'm so afraid of that. And I'm going to have Mary June Collins on, and she is not an abuse survivor. However, she has written another book, and she is willing to share how her process is for writing, and I think that's huge, because that's basically the process that all of us go through, and I think this is a good thing to point out to people. Okay, so cognitive dissonance, flying monkeys. So when we are dealing with telling our story, we feel crazy. And we feel crazy because the abuser continues to deny what happened. And for some reason, we look to the abuser to get validation for what our reality is. You cannot do that. The abuser's version of reality is the story that they can live with. So the abuser is going to twist reality, they're going to deny, they're going to change, they're going to say that your family and friends are really the abusers, or that they're horrible people, or they're this, that, or the other thing. They're trying to convince you that your kids are horrible. They're going to try to convince you to not have contact with them. And they're going to tell you whatever story they need to tell you. Oh, they're not contacting you because they're living their own lives and they're busy. Well, no, they're probably not contacting you because they're pissed at you. So this is something to consider. The biggest thing is to reconnect with the family and the friends that they have isolated you from, and to find a counselor that is going to listen to you and to believe you. Perception is everything. The abused need to be heard. And this is why it's so important to tell your story. It's important to write things down. The most important thing you can do is to write down your abuse, so that when the abuser starts twisting reality, you've got it written down for you. Now, the other thing that's going to happen is that they will, and we were talking about orders of protection, okay? They will also twist reality to the courts and to police and whatever. They will try to call the police first, or they will say that you did X, Y, and Z, or you said X, Y, and Z. They will try to tape you. They will try to do all sorts of things to try to prove that you're the crazy one. The other thing that they will do, too, is that they will make statements to the police. They will make statements to the court that are 110% untrue, and they will let you know ahead of time that they're going to do that because they want to threaten and intimidate you. They are trying to get you to drop whatever order of protection you have, and they are trying to get you to stop whatever divorce proceedings you have or custody proceedings you have. So that is what they are doing when they do that. The biggest thing that you have to remind yourself of is that you cannot give in to intimidation. I would love a Sonoran dog. I want a Sonoran dog. Absolutely. Thank you. Sorry. We're at a restaurant, in case you guys don't know. This is going to be a short show, guys, too. I just wanted to make sure to touch on this. So they will use intimidation. They will make up stuff. They will say, I'm going to tell the court this. I'm going to tell the court that. They'll believe me, not you. Blah, 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 blah. Now, some courts will believe the abuser because, again, please see the fact that a lot of people in positions of power are also abusers, and there's a lot that won't believe them. So you have to trust that you know your truth, and you need to write everything down. You need to document, 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 document. What did they say? What did you say? What was the abuse like? What did they put you through? Because you need to remind yourself what you lived through, because when it comes time for the order of protection or the divorce proceedings or the custody, whatever, they'll try to hoover you back so that they don't have to pay child support. Or they'll try to claim that you're an unfit parent and they need to have custody of all the kids. I can guarantee you it has nothing to do with the safety of the children. It has everything to do with the fact that they don't want you to get any money because they hate you because you left. And then they will twist reality. They will twist your entire relationship so that it's all your fault. So, this is what abusers do. Cognitive dissonance. For us, it is the most confusing thing ever when we know reality to be one thing, but our abuser is telling us something else, and we have to believe them. because of the fear, because of the obligation, and because of the guilt, and because the six-year-old is in charge. So I have said this before, I'm going to say this again. I want you guys to work on the inner child workbook. You must heal that inner six-year-old. You must. If you don't, you're sunk. Because the abuser is going to play on the inner child. They're going to play on that fear. They're going to play on the fear of being alone. It's a natural child fear to be alone. So when somebody tells me they're terrified of being alone, I know I'm dealing with somebody whose inner child is running the show and who's about 4, 5, 6 years old. Because 4, 5, 6 years old are the ones that are afraid of being abandoned. So you have to work on the inner child workbook. There's two workbooks out there. One is by John Bachman. The other one is by Catherine Taylor. Either one of those are good. Figure out which one resonates more with you. Get that book. Work it. If you have not read The Object of My Affection is in My Reflection, Coping with a Narcissist by Roquel Lerner. I swear to God, when I meet her in person, I'm going to say, Roquel, I love you. Shorter title. So, and I'm going to have to do the same thing, because with my book, it's you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him cha-cha. Go figure. So if you want to understand cognitive dissonance, read Object of My Affection. Also read You Can Lead a Horse to Water, But You Can't Make Him Cha-Cha, which is my book, because I talk about what the families and the friends go through and the helplessness that they feel when the target of abuse is just being abused like nobody's business, but they can't do anything about it because the target of abuse is still in the fear of the obligation and the guilt. So when we get hit with information that is conflicting with what we want to be true, honestly, we live in a lot of magic thinking when we're in the middle of the abuse. You know, oh no, mom and dad didn't mean that. No, mom and dad really do love me. No, 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 mom and dad wouldn't pit me against my brother or my sister. No, no, they wouldn't do that. Well, yeah, they would. You know, oh no, my lover loves me. They're not going to make my family and friends go away. They're not going to lie about them. Yeah, they would. So it's confronting that terror that you've been lied to. So this is the six-year-old we're dealing. So you've got to deal with the inner child. You've got to work on that original wound. You've got to heal that, because otherwise that six-year-old is going to run the fear, the obligation, and the guilt. You owe your abuser nothing. We keep going back to abuse because of the intermittent positive rewards and the fear of being abandoned. That's what's going on. So, okay. Let me try to recap here, because this is going to be a short show, guys, because I'm starving and it's 12:30 and I have not eaten. So, all right. So, and my popper is sitting there half eaten and I'm like, oh, that looks so good. Okay. So, cognitive dissonance is when we know reality is one way, but the abuser is telling us something different, but we desperately want to believe the abuser. Okay, that causes the cognitive dissonance. That's when we get confused. Anytime you're confused in a relationship, you are in the presence of an abuser that has told you that black is white, green is yellow, and up is down. You cannot believe the abuser. If the abuser is basically getting rid of all your family and friends, and the only people you're allowed to talk to are their family, their friends, you know who the abuser is. So there's that. Cognitive dissonance, again, is when we are confronted with reality, but the abuser is telling us something else and we don't want to believe it. Again, that's the inner child running the show. You've got to get the inner child under control. Flying monkeys are the ones that agree with the abuser. There's nothing you can do about flying monkeys. Get rid of them. When you leave the abuse, get rid of the flying monkeys. If family members and friends do not understand the abuse, get with a good therapist that does and help them understand. Get them to read these books. Get them to read Object of My Affection. Get them to read, you know, all these different books that I keep talking about. If, however, though, they are the cause of the original wound, it's not going to do any good. Get rid of them. If they are, you know, family members, if you were not related to them, would you have anything to do with them? If the answer is no, act accordingly. There is nothing wrong with excommunicating toxic family members, okay? So there is that. All right, guys, I am going to sign off because it is 12:33 and, oh, popper. And I'm hungry. So, all right, I know I'm sorry. This was a short show today. I'm actually celebrating in Tombstone my nephew's birthday. He's 40. Should I put him on camera?
Yeah.
So we are celebrating his 40th birthday. His favorite movie in the world is Tombstone. So I've been dragging him all over Tombstone, talking about the different sites in Tombstone and whether it was truthful and factual or not, and how the movie was, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So anyway, there's that. If you guys have any questions, please, you can find me on Facebook on We Need to Talk with Chris Godinez. Obviously, you can private message me there. You can private message me on Chris Godinez LPC. You can private message me on YouTube as well. Please do keep your comments or your questions short. Sometimes you send me novels and I know you're so excited. Yeah, I know you're so excited to talk to somebody that gets it. But honest to God, guys, I don't have time. So if you could keep it short, I would really, really appreciate it. Also to let you know, I have a book signing coming up in Tempe, Arizona, March 23rd at Changing Hands, and that is at 7 p.m. I will be doing a short lecture, probably about a half an hour, taking your questions, talking to you guys. Would love to see you guys because I'd love to put faces to names. That would be awesome. I'll be signing autographed copies of the book. Also, I have got 3 book signings coming up in Atlanta. I will be at Postman Books on the 21st. I think that's at 1. Crap. I'll have to look. Anyway, so that's at Postman Books. I'll also be... What? Oh, go to Eventbrite. Yes, thank you. Go to Eventbrite. Thank you. Go to Eventbrite and look up Atlanta, Chris Godinez, and it will have all of my events there. So I'll be at Postman Books, I'll be at Tall Tales, and then I'm also doing a seminar lecture in Smyrna. Go to Eventbrite. Smyrna, Georgia. I'm not quite sure where that is. I guess I'll find out. So at the community center there, and we are selling tickets for that. The two book signings are free, obviously. So unless you buy a book, of course. But so that's where you can find my book. You can lead a horse to water, but you cannot make them cha-cha. You can't make them cha-cha. So Tempe, Arizona, March 23rd, 7 p.m. Atlanta, Georgia, Postman Books and Tall Tale Books. And then I'll be doing a seminar there. All right, I am going to peace out because I would like to eat. All right, I will talk to you guys later. Love you. Have a great week and send all your questions. And I'm going to do another little one this week because I know I gypped you guys on this show. So sorry, but, you know, birthday. So anyway, all right. Love you guys. Bye.